Well, let me first say thank you very much for this opportunity to work in this network as a partner country. I will take a few minutes to take you through some very basic broad sort of picture of what we're facing in India with regard to issues of sustainable development or unsustainable development and the challenges that we have. Okay, so this is the development context. Just to tell you, the scale of the country is huge. So we are 1.3 billion people, and two-thirds of these actually live in villages, which are huge. And we have urban centers of about 8,000, of which there are 75 mega cities, but which are overcrowded. So there's a huge influx of people from rural areas in search of livelihood, etc. The state of Uttar Pradesh, which is our largest state, alone has 180 million people, so equivalent to the entire Europe. India has the second largest Muslim population, and we have 18 official languages, and we have about 30 to 40 million speaking one of these official languages, and over 1,000 active dialects. There are many more which are not quite active. And the bulk of the poor live in the region of South Asia, of course, and within that in India. India has deep asymmetries across gender, caste, ethnicity, language, religion. Now, these are two slides I'm going to show just to give you a context, which IIHS has actually put together because they work in the area of climate action and sustainable cities. If you look at this, basically they've taken regional indicators, not the global indicators of sustainable development goals. And you can see India is doing poorly in most of the dashboard shows. The red actually means significant major challenges. The ochre shows significant challenges, and there's one single amber which shows challenges remain. So we haven't sort of moved from the challenge prospect of it. And if you see the trends, these are the last 3 years of trends that show the arrows. And there is some improvement, of course, in economic growth. But as I speak, I think this quarter of growth has come down considerably because of poor economic policies. Poverty, yes, we've been able to achieve something. The sort of arrows that are inclined show some kind of improvement, but the ones that are horizontal show a stagnation of a kind. Now, this is an interesting slide that tells us if you look at the entire country at one go, the means and the averages actually don't tell us the story. So you have to look at each of the states. So if we're doing okay in terms of economic growth over the last 3 years, not now, then it's only a few states and which are really their major sort of per capita incomes are much better, and therefore the mean averages go up. So I won't take too long on that, but we've done a lot of analysis of the entire country along each of the states using the SDGs. I'll now come to the educational context, where I'd like to just share that basically India started focusing on work and universalizing elementary education only in late 20th century. And the education reforms, when they started with the World Bank-funded DPEP program, the District Primary Education Program, early 90s, that time we were 52% literate and the gender disparity was 20%. We are still hovering at 18% on that. And these reforms were focused on pedagogical renewal, but the teacher became the object of reform rather than a partner in the reforms. And that has been a major problem. Donor-led reforms actually led to major sort of structural changes, and these have created problems for us now. So, for example, the common targets, which the Millennium Development Goals and the AFAIR movement, when it began, you see, it was across without looking at social context, cultural context, and the result was that bureaucracy sort of came in just to chase targets, and therefore suboptimal solutions became the norm. The central government assumed a much greater role. Initially, it was a state subject education, but it became concurrent, which also meant that now the controls of the center have become far stronger because there seems to be a stake in that. Parallel structures were set up, and this really caused a dismantling of the existing structures which were not involved in the reforms that were instituted. So the consequences was that we did have an increased school enrollment, there was international pressure, we tried to do that, but we inundated the school system with para teachers. This is a term that only India has, actually. I mean, teachers that are not really professionally qualified and do not even have the basic qualification have flooded the school system. And this has also led to a dysfunctionality of the state school system, leading many parents to choose private schools that came up as a result of global policy advocacy and neoliberal measures. And the institutional capacity to prepare teachers, of course, remained neglected because the pre-service education of teachers was never seen as important, and that led to deeper penetration of the market. Now, interestingly, the right to education, which is elementary level from class 1 to class 8, came in 2009, but this came at a time when our system was deeply fractured already. So the right to education came at a time when we didn't have much to offer. It was perceived as dysfunctional, shortfall of teachers, large presence of untrained teachers, and also, therefore, a movement to private schools, which means that India's state schools actually have fewer children now. Not comparatively, I mean, we still are a very large system, but at the time when it's the right to education moment. Several private players, of course, came even in terms of teacher education. There was a need to prepare teachers, so the private players came in from all kinds of quarters with very little understanding of education, led to teaching shops, and currently we have 95% of India's teacher training institutes in the private sector and 80% of children still in the state sector of schooling. The current key challenges, therefore, are the rapidly growing private school sector in most of the backward states where there is poor institutional capacity and the learning levels of children, which are referred to as the learning crisis, are very, very low. And declining state investment in school education now with this particular government in after 2019, there's been further decline. So now we have very little institutional scope to address challenges of what we're calling quality education, because that itself is also, you know, facing challenges in terms of neoliberal frames within which it is being defined. There have been recent amendments to the right to education, which has taken away the very potency of the act itself, because now we are calling the right to education as right to learning. So everything is boiling down to some kind of learning outcomes, which is not really helping us to achieve the goals of education. Large number of private substandard teacher education institutes exist, and despite intervention of the Supreme Court of India, the state investment in teacher education continues to be low, and the system of teacher preparation is isolated from higher education, which is a key problem. And teachers and their preparation, of course, I think, remains a very critical missing link. There are some examples of transformative education that we can speak of, which I think we will try and draw upon as we work in this project. We've had very potent NGO-based innovations, which also led to the National Curriculum Framework that we created in 2005, cutting-edge school textbooks that talked of diversity, marginalization, the idea of looking at India and preparing children in far more holistic ways with a framework of social justice, and the National Curriculum for Teacher Education. So for the first time in the history of India, these two sort of came in consonance. And those have been inflection points. But once the change of government happened, then once again, we are sort of slipping back because the political always seems to define whether we move forward or we move backward. Instituting teacher research as a learning framework for professional development has also been very interesting. We've got some very good researches by teachers which show how co-production of knowledge can happen and how it influences the way practitioners then look at their own work in classroom settings. And of course, the 4-year integrated Bachelor of Elementary Education program, now in its 25th year, a radical departure from any teacher training so far. And we've had excellent graduates coming out and participating in national exercises. So many of these ideas have come into the national discourse in terms of curriculum frameworks, but the challenges of implementation remain. Thank you very much.